So the topic which I'm going to discuss today is one of the very interesting topic, and it's control, right? First, before starting, I would like to ask all of you, when you heard this topic name, how many of you have thought like this, that we are going to discuss something about aliens or the microorganism which is present on some Mars or moon or Jupiter or Saturn, somewhere like that? How many of you thought like that? Maybe you can respond in chat box so that I'll come to know. How many of you thought like that alien microorganism means the microbes which is present on some other planets? Yes, I am seeing many yes, right? But microbiology is a very simple science. Okay, it's not a space science or rocket science. It's very simple science, and actually we are not going to Mars or moon or some other planet. So far, there is no proper, information available for such information. So, I think you should not get disappointed by knowing that. Okay, we'll try to keep content interactive and informative. Hope you will learn by the end some new things which you might have not studied during your regular classes. So, I will start with a small, story, and it's a true one, right? It's a story of the yellow crazy ant and the Christmas island. Okay, this particular story will keep the things in perspective, and you will understand basically what is the meaning of invasive alien species or invasive alien microorganisms, right? So, 70 years ago, a species called the yellow crazy ant turned up at the Christmas island of Australia. Perhaps it stuck to a piece of timber, and with the flow of water, it somehow reached to this island. Right now, this island is very near to, I think it is just 100 kilometer away from the Perth. You might have heard of Perth, very popular cricket destination. Indian team is already in Australia for playing games, right? So for a long time, this ant remained dormant, right? Then in the mid 1990s, its population begins to explode. It started growing at very, very rapid rate. We do not know why, what was the reason, but it happened. That was the observation people has made that time. Okay, colony, very, very long colonies, right? Some of them are as large as 700 hectares, which is a very, very long size, right? The species swarm in the island colonized by colonizing the entire island, and by 2003 itself, 2000 hectares of the tropical forest literally chewed up by all the litter and by all the litter and canopy fina. It means the entire forest is almost damaged by this ants. All flora, fauna, all of them are damaged by this particular ants, right? In the last 5 years, the crazy yellow ants has also consumed 20 million red crabs, which was one of the very abundant species on that island before the yellow ants, yellow crazy ant invaded this island. Now, if we talk about current situation, now Christmas Island red crab are a disseminated species. The forest robbed off its all pollinators, that is like spider, insects, birds, and all flies. And it is going to the way of a deadwood. Okay, that is the kind of impact a invasive species is having, right? Here, the yellow crazy ant was the invasive species, and while the flora and fauna present affected, and you can see the impact of just one species. So that is the kind of impact a invasive microorganism could have. Still, those who do not understand what is the meaning of invasive species or invasive microorganisms will discuss here in the introduction section. So the study of and microorganisms that have been moved to the region beyond their native range, and as such are termed alien species. It means a microorganism, a plant, fungi, they have reached to a place where they were earlier not been known to be present. Then we call them alien species to that new geographical location, right? So far, the term we have discussed is alien species only. Okay, Now, the second term is invasive alien species, IAS, right? So those alien species that causes negative effects, or you can say harms, okay, on biodiversity or society or on the economy are termed as invasive alien species, right? Now, if we talk specifically in context of microorganisms, so we can say microorganisms that causes harm, okay, they will be considered as invasive alien microorganisms. So which the microorganism generally causes harms are known as pathogens, right? So you pathogens, okay, that term could also be a right term, right? So invasive alien species reproduces rapidly. They outcompete the native species for food, water, and space, and are one of the main cause of global biodiversity loss, right? Now, invasive any one of the reason. One of them is intentional reasons. For example, we are doing fish farming, we bring up a new fish from some other country, from some other area, and start one geographical location to the other one, right? Horticulture practices, where again we bring some plants from some place to other place. Biocontrol agents, biofertilizers, that includes biofertilizers and biopesticides, basically. Again, they include microorganisms. So these are some intentional uses where we introduce a type of species to a new place. And then there could be some unintentional reasons also by which a species could be introduced to a new place. That basically includes, land and water transportation, travel, and scientific research. If I would have discussed this topic before 1 year, before this outbreak of COVID-19, it might be very difficult for you to understand, but I'm pretty sure by the end, when we will finish this lecture, you all will be very much, knowing about the thing which we are going to discuss today, because in last 6 months, all of you have seen a very, very, unique invasive microorganism, that is this coronavirus, novel coronavirus 2. It is a classical example of invasive species, invasive alien microorganism or invasive alien pathogen. We'll discuss about all these things in the coming slides. Now, some of the examples of, see, so far I'm only talking about invasive alien species. Still, I haven't come on invasive alien microorganism. We will come on to that little later. So, examples of invasive alien species. So, one of the very classical example of this is South American cob, which is a rodent. As you can see in this diagram, it is looking like a mouse only, or rat only, you can say. So the South American rodent, it became invasive in North America and Europe, and also in Asia, where, when it became invasive, it caused both environmental and economical impact, consuming aquatic vegetations and undermining riverbanks. So it was very dangerous, and it led to a lot of losses. Similarly, the Eastern Arctic brown moderate sink bug, okay, is a successful global invader. Okay, so it was basically, native to this place, Eastern Ascetics. Okay, from there it has become global invader, and now it is found almost around the world. And there it causes severe economical damage to the agricultural crop. And agricultural crops are one of the very important source of generating economics. So eventually to the economics also. I hope the examples are clear that these species are moving from their native environment, native place, to some other place, and causing some kind of harm to maybe to the humans, to the animals, to the environment, and so on. Right. Now, what it takes for a species to become invasive? It's not that easy that any species, whenever it want, it can become invasive. The chances of becoming invasive is very, very less. So what is required? What is the basic sequence of becoming invasive? So usually, if you follow this flow chart, it's a very simple flow chart. Usually, the species initially present in its native condition or native atmosphere, right? From there, the species enters dispersal pathway. Dispersal means it gets spreaded from there. It gets spreaded to some other places, or you can say transmission. Now, during this, what happens? Whatever the species are moving, 90% of them will fail to disperse, and they will again, restrict themselves to their native place itself. The reason is they may not be able to find the suitable conditions which might be required for their growth and development. However, maybe 10% of them can thrive, okay, and they can disperse, they can get dispersed to the other environment, right? Then the species survive dispersal and is introduced to a new habitat. Obviously, when it will get transmitted, dispersed, it will reach to a new habitat. Now, again, in this new habitat, 90%, approximately 90% of these species will not be able to thrive, and they will be failed to establish, and they will again be restricted to their natural atmosphere, natural habitat itself. However, again, few of them, maybe up to 10% of them, might be able to overcome this, and they may establish themselves as a casual species to that area, right? Again, out of that also, 90% will remain as casual species only, and they can't further spread. Okay, they may establish themselves to that new area, but they may not be able to spread further. 90% of that may not be able to spread further. Only 10% of them might further invade, and further spread to other locations, and the cycle may continue, right? So that is the process which any microorganism has to follow before becoming invasive. And you know, now if you find out here, the chances of becoming invasive by this simple calculation is just 0.1%, less than 0.1%, right? So it's not that easy that a microorganism can easily become invasive. It's very important for microorganism to be very highly adapted if it want to be adapted, invasive in nature. I hope the point is clear. Alien species. Now we will try to focus more on microorganisms, right? So although now we have several advanced technologies to do research, a little research has been done to understand about alien microorganisms. As per the information available, there are two possibilities in regard of alien species, alien microbial species basically. One of them is microorganism can themselves be alien microorganism, or you can say alien pathogens, or the microorganisms can be spreaded by the invasive alien species such as plants, you know, such as animals, such as, you know, insects and so on. You know, different type of other invasive species can also harbor microorganism in them, and those microorganisms can also spread, right? So this is two possibilities. Either a microorganism itself could be alien microorganism, and second possibility is a new microorganism might be present in a invasive species like plant, animal, or insects or something else. I hope the point is clear to here, right? So now we will be talking more about this. So alien pathogens and pathogens spreaded by invasive alien species. So we will be focusing on these two things. As I already discussed, or as I already told you, beside acting as pathogen themselves, invasive alien species can contribute to the transmission and invasion of pathogens by acting as host of the parasite. It means invasive alien species can act as a host for the microorganisms, right? And thus they can help in their spread. Similarly, invasive alien species can also represent the natural habitat or reservoir. It means they can also act as a reservoir for the pathogenic microorganism and maintains the parasite over the time within them, right? Like one of the very classical example for this is, you know, crows, you know, crow, blue jay, crow, there are different varieties of crow, right? They can harbor, or they can act as a reservoir for West Nile virus. And because of that, you know, now West Nile virus is very common in US, where before 25 years, it was not at all there, right? We'll talk about. Additionally, there are invasive alien species acting as a facilitator of host and or to vectors of the pathogens, right? So sometimes they can facilitate these host, the microorganism or the vector for spreading the disease. Now, question is, okay, fine, there are invasive alien species, but why we should be bothering about them? Why we should care about invasive alien microbes? There is a big reason behind it, right? So introduction of alien microorganisms or alien species, that is like plant, animals, insects, with the risk of carrying pathogens and their biological invasion may therefore contribute substantially to the spread of emerging infectious disease. I think we have several LPU students, and they have in their syllabus this particular topic, emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases. So I think they can correlate it better, right? So in emerging infectious diseases, which represent a major threat not only to humans but also to the biodiversity and ecosystem services, right? The anthropogenic movement of pathogens, like that is hu human made movement of pathogen into new geographical locations or host species, is known as pathogen pollution. Do remember this, it's a very important term for different type of competitive exams: pathogen pollution. Emerging infectious disease may affect livestock, crops, and ultimately wildlife. Those who do not know what is the meaning of emerging infectious disease: an emerging infectious disease is one that has appeared and affected a population for the first time within a population, or it's spread to a new geographical areas, right? So emerging infectious disease is quite similar to that of invasive alien species. There's a lot of similarities. There's a list of examples of pathogens described as invasive alien species in the Global Invasive Species Database. There is a database by this name, Global Invasive Species Database. So far they have announced officially these different microorganisms: bacteria, virus, parasites, fungi, and some other microorganisms as invasive alien species. I think with that you can clearly understand that world is looking towards it. But by seeing this small list, you can understand very well that still lot of research has to be carried out in this particular area, right? So source for this is Global Invasive Species Database. Our question is, what is Global Invasive Species Database? So the Global Invasive Species Database is a free online that negatively impact biodiversity. The Global Invasive Species Database is managed by the Invasive Species Organization, along with IUCN, that is International Union of Conserving Nature, okay, Species Survival Commission. So these are two very prominent organizations which is excessively working in invasive alien species, right? So they have a database where you can search about various invasive alien microorganisms. This database was developed between 1998 and 2000 as a part of global initiative on invasive species led by the erstwhile Global Invasive Species Program, right? Now this is the website for it. If you want, I can give you a very small demo on this. You can copy this link. If you want, you can note down, and I have already opened this website. When you will open this link, it will come like this. And here, there's a search option. Like for example, I want to search a microorganism like West Nile virus. West, okay, it will automatically come, right? Then you can go into search, and then you will find the details like this, and here is a hyperlink. So you can find all the details related to this invasive microorganism over here. So this database can be utilized. World-renowned and world-accepted database for studying invasive alien species. So you guys can use this to clarify or to study more in detail. I hope the point is clear up to here. Now we will discuss few more examples. So as we were talking about West Nile virus, so we will start from West Nile virus itself. So in 1999, some people in New York became ill with apparent viral encephalitis, and several of them, and death of wild birds, especially crows, were also reported. Diagnostic test revealed that these human patients and the birds were infected with West Nile virus. This virus has been known since 1937, so it means it was not at all a new virus. It was a very old virus. Incidents happened after approximately 60 years, in 1999, 62 years nearly, when it was first isolated from the blood of a woman in West Nile region of Uganda in Africa, right? Until 1999, in addition to Africa, the virus was reported in the Eastern Europe, West Africa, and Middle East. So, is it clear? However, by this time, this virus was not reported in New York, which is a part of U.S., right? So that means in 1999, West Nile virus became invasive to the U.S. also. And it is not known how West Nile virus was introduced into North America, but once there is a spread rapidly throughout the US within 5 years. So by 2005 itself, the almost West Nile virus was quite prevalent in entire US. So that way you can understand that how invasive microorganisms could quickly multiply and spread into some regions. If you remember, while talking about invasive alien species, the first point I discussed was they are rapid growers. They can thrive very quickly into the area. Okay? They can overtake the native populations or native organisms. Okay. So here you can, I think, easily understand with this example. Second example is blue tongue virus. Right? There are many examples. I have just chosen few examples. If you want, you can search many more examples, which is available in various research papers and even in books also. In Africa and Middle East for long time, and known to cause disease in ruminants. Right? In affected and some affected animals, tongue virus. Right? Blue tongue virus is transmitted by the bite of mange, which is a type of small fly. So the virus remains restricted to the areas of the world where this particular type of fly is present. And as you know, I think everybody will agree with me that all the insects, okay, they are not present throughout the year. There is a season that time type of insects, right? So it was restricted to the area where this kind of fly was found, and that too only during the time of the year when this fly was usually active. Okay. Other than this, occasionally it has made brief incursions in Europe, but in 1998, six serotypes of blue tongue virus began to spread north of Europe. It has been found that the mange species has extended its range north in Europe, presumably because of the climate change. Okay, as we know, now the climate is getting warmer because of global warming, and that is again influencing the spread of new alien species or to the different areas of the world. So this is one classical example where weather is playing an important role in increasing the or in making microorganisms more invasive, okay, and making them alien to the new areas. I hope the point is clear. One more very good example of this is SARS corona of the SARS coronavirus only. Right, but the first the strain which right now has been reported, it is called as SARS coronavirus 2. The first SARS coronavirus 1 or novel coronavirus 1 strain was reported in 2002, right, in China, right, and it was responsible for causing some respiratory disease. The following year, one of the doctors who has been treating patients traveled to Hong Kong. So initially, for 1 year, that one entire year, the disease was restricted only to China. It didn't spread to any other parts. But the following year, one of the doctors who has been treating patients traveled to Hong Kong, where he became ill and died. Subsequently, people who have stayed in the same hotel as the doctor traveled to Singapore, Vietnam, Canada, US, okay, taking the infectious agents with them. The causative isn't found to be new coronavirus or novel coronavirus. Now you can say novel coronavirus 1, right? That time they just name it novel coronavirus or coronavirus. So no natural reservoir for SARS coronavirus had been found at that point of time. But coronavirus with very similar genome sequence were isolated from animals sold in the market in the regions of China, right? However, exactly the similar genotype was never identified. These viruses were found in many workers in the market, but none of the workers had any history of SARS. A similar virus has also been isolated from several bird species, but again, the genome was little different. Right? That shows that how a virus can move from one area to other area and can become a invasive alien species to the new areas. Okay, so I think up to here, what examples I discussed to you, you can understand that I was directly talking about microorganisms, right? Which is getting spread to new areas. Now I will be talking about invasive alien species other than microorganisms like plant, insects, mosquitoes, animals, how they are contributing, for the spread of microorganisms, right? So invasive alien species such as plant, animal, insects may host pathogens that are absent in the area of release and causes their establishment and subsequent spillovers to the local species, possibly resulting in an increase of risk, disease risk for humans, domestic animals, and native wildlife. There are several examples of this. Here, I will try to discuss a few examples to you. Right. First of them is the North American racon. Okay, when introduced, so North American. So remember this, it was native to North America. So North American racon, when introduced in Central Europe, it spreaded this particular nematode. I think you know what is nematode. Nematodes are roundworms. Okay, Valiascaris, Procainiosis. So this particular nematode was spreaded by this into Central Europe because this particular organism, this particular racon, was a invasive alien species to the Central Europe. And this particular organism, this racon, was carrying this particular nematode. I hope you can understand. It's clear, right? Is a nematode causing this nematode was responsible for causing larva migraine, which is a syndrome potentially including several central nervous system disease in humans. So it became very common in that area. Similarly, other example is a American carryfish, okay, introduced into Europe, which led to the spread of the fungus Ephenomyces estica in native carryfish and caused huge economical losses in the fisheries industry, right? So as obviously, if you remember, I told you know, a invasive alien species can be introduced to a new area because of commercial purpose, like, you know, fishery people who deal in fisheries, okay, they have introduced this carryfish to a new area, you know, from America to Europe, right? Along with that, they also, you know, this fish also brings this particular fungi, and which also spread it into the carryfish, which was native to the Europe, and that led to the huge economical loss in that industry. Similarly, you know, squirrel pox virus introduced to the United Kingdom along with the American eastern gray squirrels, okay, is significantly contributing to the increased mortality of native red squirrel into that particular area. So again, you can understand, a new animal was brought from one area to other area, and along with this animal, it also carried a virus, that is squirrel pox virus. Okay, and that became very prominent in that those areas, new areas. Similarly, invasive alien species can also act as an amplifier of local pathogens, right? Pathogens which is already present, right? An increase of local disease risk may also occur if the introduced invasive alien species is susceptible to and able to transmit to local pathogens, right? Pathogens acquired by invasive alien species may be amplified and possibly spill back to humans and local species, right? Again, some examples of this is like Australian possum. As you can see in the diagram, this is possum, kind of a rodent. Okay. This basically, it was native to Australia, but it invaded into New Zealand. I think you know both of them are island countries, right? So it invaded into New Zealand and became infected with Mycobacterium bovis in 19 during 1960s, right? Currently they are most important maintenance host, or you can say intermediate host, for bovine tuberculosis, right? Supporting higher transmission rate compared to the local species. Is it clear? And also responsible for the transmission of this Mycobacterium bovis between animals and the forest residents, people who lives in forest, right, among them. So you can see here, this possum is playing a major role in the transmission of Mycobacterium bovis. It is a, you know, more, you can say, potent spreader of the disease than that of the native species which were already there in that area. So you can understand how it is amplifying the local pathogen, right? Similarly, other example is represented by invasive raccoon dogs, right, which may amplify rabies circulation in Eastern Europe or causes its re-emergence in currently rabies-free countries because they can migrate to those areas along with the virus infected inside them. I hope it's clear. And the last factor in this is indirect mechanism by which invasive alien species can disrupt local infection dynamics. Invasive alien species may disrupt local infection dynamics through competitive interactions with native species, or by modification of local habitats. So what they do, thus altering the abundance and or contact rate among local host species, parasite infective stage, or with the vector, right? Now examples includes, like, you know, in southern Florida, the invasive python, okay, caused the decrease of several mammal species. Several mammal species, as you know, python basically feeds on the mammals, right? Small mammals particularly, including the local inducing the local mosquito vector of zoonotic this Everglen virus to feed almost exclusively on the virus main reservoir host, that is Hapsid cotton rat. See, earlier this mosquito was having several mammals host, okay? But when this python started eating these rodents, what happens? This mosquito was not finding enough of the mammals to bite them. So what it did is, this mosquito is doing now, it is mainly focusing on its main that the biting rate, or you can say the incidence rate in Hapsid cotton rat has significantly increased. So that is how it is affecting the contact rate, obviously, right? Here the contact rate of mosquito with the Hapsid cotton rat has significantly increased because of this python which has been introduced to the new areas. Okay, so that is how they can affect. Similarly, in the island of Hawaii, invasive feral pigs, okay, create valves and cavities in the tree trunks. जैसे होता है ना, गड्ढे से बना लेते हैं, दे मेक सम पिट्स इन द यू नो रिवर बैंक्स, इन द यू नो कैविटीज इन द ट्री ट्रंक्स एंड सो ऑन, राइट? व्हिच ट्रंक्स इंप्रूविंग हैबिटेट व्हिच इज वेरी सूटेबल फॉर मॉस्किटो वेक्टर्स फॉर एवियन मलेरिया, दैट इज प्लाज्मोडियम रेल्टिकम, व्हिच इज वन ऑफ द मेन थ्रेट टू द नेटिव हवाईयन फॉरेस्ट बर्ड. इज इट क्लियर? सो व्हेन दे मेक द पिट, आई थिंक ऑल ऑफ यू नो दैट मलेरिया is spread by the mosquito bite, right? Anopheles mosquito, as we know, right? And you might have seen various advertisements in TV that we should not be allowing water to become stagnant, especially in, like, you know, small pits like coconut shells and so on. But what this pig is doing, they are creating those small pits and all, not intentionally, that is their own habit, but they are doing it, which is further supporting the rearing of these mosquito vectors, and thus the chances of spreading this avian malaria that is caused by Plasmodium rectum has increased, which is very risky to the Hawaiian forest world. I hope you can understand this, how they can disrupt local infection dynamics. So I think that is all about the basics of invasive alien microorganisms. I have tried to quoted you examples from a different type, and you know, it could be studied more in detail, but you know, in 1 hour, as I have 1 hour time, so I have tried to keep the things concise, and I think now we will talk about second part of the presentation, that is control, or you can say effective handling of invasive alien species, right? Now, according to the International Union for Conservation of Nature, IUCN, the invasive alien species can be handled effectively by following, following strategies, right? One of them is understanding and creating awareness towards a particular invasive alien species. Second is prevention from invasive alien species, right? And third and the last one is eradication and control from that, right? So as you can understand this, if we create awareness, if we create understanding, we can reduce the chances of happening. When it is happening, if we follow the prevention methods, we can reduce its risk. But if prevention methods fail, eradication or its control. So that is why these three strategies, which is step by strategies, can be followed, right? So we'll talk about all of them one by one. So first is understanding and awareness. So for this, you know, we have to, again, all these data, now what I'm going to discuss, it has been taken from the guideline of IUCN 2000, which is available on internet. You can download it if you want, right? Or if you want, I can share it with you. So in this, first, what we have to do is to create the understanding and awareness about invasive alien species. As you, I think by now you might have understood that invasive alien species could be, you know, anything. You know, it could be a plant, it could be एनिमल, इट कुड बी यू नो मॉस्किटो, इट कुड बी ए इंसेक्ट और एनीथिंग, राइट, एंड माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिज्म ऑब्वियसली, राइट. इन माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स ऑल्सो इट कुड बी डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिज्म, स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम इकोलाई टू कॉलरा और टू माइकोबैक्टीरियम एंड सो ऑन, राइट. सो द स्ट्रेटजीज ऑर्गेनिज्म, राइट. करेंटली वी आर टेकिंग लॉट ऑफ मेजर्स टू हैंडल कोरोना वायरस, विच माइट नॉट बी नेसेसरी टू हैंडल इफ देर इज ए आउटब्रेक ऑफ और इफ देर इज ए स्प्रेड ऑफ बिब्रियो कॉलरा, यू नो. सो द एक्चुअल एक्सपेरिमेंटल स्ट्रेटजीज माइट बी वेरी, बट हियर वॉट वी आर टॉकिंग इज हाउ टू डिजाइन दोज स्ट्रेटजीज, वॉट वी हैव टू प्लान वेल डिजाइनिंग दोज स्ट्रेटजीज. वी विल बी मेनली फोकसिंग ऑन दैट, राइट. सो फॉर बेटर अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड क्रिएटिंग अवेयरनेस अबाउट इन्वेजिव एलियन स्पीशीज, फॉलोइंग इज द पॉइंट विच वी कैन फॉलो. फर्स्ट थिंग इज टू आइडेंटिफाई द स्पीशीज इंट्रैक्ट्स, स्पेसिफिक इंट्रैक्ट्स एंड द रोल ऑफ relevant sectors and communities with respect to the alien invasive species, species issues, and targets them with the appropriate information and recommended actions. So those whoever, from wherever there is a chances of getting alien species, okay, we need to provide them appropriate informations. For example, as we all know now, this coronavirus has came from, China to India, or from US or from Italy to India, as the passengers were traveling during the outbreak in China and in those areas, right. Now the in such this outbreak, who are all the responsible parties? Responsible parties was the person who is traveling. Second is the people who is in airport authorities, okay, government of India and other peoples also, right. But because the appropriate information and the techniques were not available, right, they failed to control it effectively, and now soon after that it large number of cases started coming throughout the country. So if we have better understanding of a microorganism or a invasive alien species, then we should provide it to the concerned persons, okay, whoever is responsible for handling it. Okay, make the information easily accessible. Current and accurate information should be widely available as a key component of awareness raising. Otherwise, what happens? People will just read WhatsApp messages or Facebook post, and just by seeing that they will create awareness, right? Which is not good. I remember in one of our class WhatsApp group, I got a some student were chatting, and they were saying that coronavirus is not a virus; it's a bacteria. Maybe that student is present here also in this group. Maybe, I'm not sure, right? But this is the kind of information we may get, which is complete information is not accurate. So the information should come from the concerned authorities, and in such kind of cases, the concerned authorities could be Health Ministry or Environment and Forest Ministry and so on. DBT, that is Department of Biotechnology, or ICMR, WHO, and those bodies also. And other than that, we should also encourage the private sector to develop and follow best practice guidelines and monitor adherence to the guidelines, which is very, very important, right? If you have made a set of guidelines, if they are not being followed properly, then again you can't control anything, right? So this is also very important. As an important priority, provide information and recommendations, recommended actions to the travelers, because travelers can bring in lot of microorganisms from other countries. Classical example is this coronavirus itself, or even the coronavirus one which got reported in China, Vietnam, Thailand, Malaysia, and all earlier in 2003 or so, right? So, as an important priority, provide information and recommended actions to the travelers, both within country and between the countries. Now, if you guys go to some one place to other place by train, you will get a message in your mobile that you should be wearing mask, you should carry hand sanitizer with you. This is the kind of message you will get in your mobile. Okay, although still we are in very, very basic stage of handling this kind of problems, but people have started following, they are seeing it for the first time. Entire world is seeing this kind of outbreak for the first time in their life. Okay, earlier this kind of outbreak happened in 1920 only, 1980 only, 18, right? So I hope the point is clear up to here. Train the staff for quarantine, border control, and for other relevant facilities, which is very, very important, because if your staff is not trained, you might find so many people who is taking samples, they are not, they themselves are not bearing mask. Even if they are bearing mask, their mask is below their nose, right? You might have seen in news. I remember the initial days of corona outbreak. People, who, one person was checking temperature by using that, that infrared thermometer in railway station, and he's talking in phone, seeing somewhere, and just doing like this, right? So the staff should be trained for quarantine, border control, and for other relevant facilities. You might remember, most of you might remember how people were getting thrashed by the police, when lockdown started. So all these things should also be handled, in a better way, and for that, the better training should be given to the staff for related facilities, different kind of facilities. Even you might have heard people are in hospitals and nobody is taking care of them because even the staff is afraid. The reason is they are not well trained, right? So training of staff is one of the very, very important aspect in understanding and creating awareness regarding any invasive alien species. ठीक है, include invasive alien species issue and the action that can be taken to address them in appropriate place in education programs and schools, like maybe in courses like you are studying BSc microbiology or biotechnology or any program. So there, this kind of chapter should be there, okay, so that you will have an idea that what is your responsibilities, what should be done in these cases, and obviously those who are more interested in them. The point is clear up to here, right? Next, after awareness, we can go for prevention. Awareness is fine up to one extent only. Awareness can help you, awareness can stop the invasion of microorganisms. But after a point, awareness may not be sufficient, and we may need to seek preventive measures, right? Now, whenever we talk about preventive measure, there's two things. We can prevent something which is been spreading or which is happening unintentionally, and there is a chance somebody is trying to spread it intentionally. You might have heard, again, I am talking about coronavirus. Don't think there's no other examples, but I think all of you are aware about this. You might have heard there is a lot of debate. Even US President Donald Trump at that point of time said that it is Chinese virus, right? He used this term in several of his press conferences, right? So he said that China has used this as a bioweapon, which has still not been proved, right? So one thing is a microorganism, a invasive microorganism has got invaded due to unintentional reasons. And the second possibility is the microorganism or the invasive alien species has been introduced to a new area with the intention, like a bioweapon, for example, right? So first we are talking about what kind of actions we should take to prevent unintentional invasion of a microorganism. So for that, first we have to identify and manage pathways leading to the unintentional introduction of invasive alien species to an area. Now, what is this kind of pathway? Some of the examples includes national and international trades. When I'm buying something from other countries, along with that, that sample, the material which I'm buying might have a dangerous microorganism with it, which I don't know as a buyer. Okay, so that could happen. So national and international trade has to be monitored. Tourism, right? Many of these cases of coronavirus came into India because of tourism only, right? Then shipping, again, I think shipping is almost same. Something is coming from foreign country or some other area to your area and carrying microorganisms with it. Blaster water, that is nothing but the water which has been released by the ship when they're docking at some place. So that may also have some microorganism from different areas. Fisheries, ठीक है, we have already discussed one example of fisheries, that carry fish example. Agriculture, where you are introducing a new crop and that may have some microorganism in it. ठीक है, construction project, ground and air transport, forestry, horticulture, landscaping, pet trade and aquaculture. These are some of the examples, where these practices may lead to the introduction of invasive alien species unintentionally. People who is doing them, they might not know that the process which they're following might lead to the introduction of a microorganism also along with it. ठीक है, following that, what we have to do is we need to develop collaborative industrial guidelines and code of conduct which minimizes or eliminates unintentional introduction of invasive alien species, which is very important. It means if you're bringing any invasive alien species to a new area, appropriate permissions has to be taken, responsibility has to be taken, and all those things should be done, right? Implement the appropriate initiatives to reduce the problem of alien invasive arising from the equipments used. You know, sometimes, you know, the transmission could happen due to the instruments, you know, the machinery, due to the vehicles which you are using. Like I told you the example of ship, right? Ship, when a ship is going to a dock, you know, when it want to stay at that point, it fills the water. And when it want to leave, it just release that water, right? So in that process, it may bring up a microorganism from one continent or one country to other country, from one state to other state, wherever the ship is traveling, right? So same way, you know, various instruments, machines which you are using. I think all of you know, if you do not, you know, disinfect your medical instruments like catheters, for example, you know, the respiratory, you know, that mask and all, and if some other person is using, then you know they may get that infection. Same thing will happen, that transmission of alien microorganism could happen because of instruments also, and that's why proper strategies and proper research has to be done to eliminate this, right? Quarantine and border control regulations and facilities and trained staff to inspect the unintentional introduction of alien species should be done, right? Then other than this, this is very important, appropriate fine. You know, there should be a policy for appropriate fine, okay, penalties and other sentence that might be imprisonment or something else, okay, other sentence to apply to those responsible for unintentional introduction, but because of their negligence and bad practices. You know, if they are doing negligence and bad practices, then it is the responsibility of those persons and a strict action must be taken against them, right? Then we should have in place the necessary provisions for taking rapid and effective action, which is very important because as you know, specifically we talk about India, if you know that most of the government systems, you know, most of the decision making, it takes long time because of bureaucracy. So all these things, you know, should have the people or should have the systems where the actions could be taken quickly and the action should be effective also. I hope the point is clear. So these are the things we can do for preventing unintentional, you know, introduction of invasive alien species. And then second point, possibility is somebody is trying to intentionally release these microorganisms to new area. So for them, what we should do is we should establish an appropriate institutional mechanism such as biosecurity. I hope you understand what is the basic difference between biosafety and security. Biosecurity is very, very important. And those who guys who are really interested in biosafety and biosecurity, there is a information for all of you that in month of February, we will be conducting a on this aspect only, biosafety and biosecurity. We will share you the details on this WhatsApp group itself. So remain connected on this group. Right. So we should establish a appropriate institutional mechanism such as biosecurity. You know, somebody is trying to cheat you. Somebody is trying to, you know, hide something. So you does not want safety. You want security for it. Somebody is trying to scold you. You want security for it. Is it clear? So biosecurity is little different than that of biosafety. Right. So we should have biosecurity measures in hand, and for that we should have different type of agencies or authorities as a part of legislative reforms on invasiveness, right? We should also empower the biosecurity agencies, okay, or other institutional mechanisms. Can you tell me in India, do we have any biosecurity agency? Anybody in chat box, maybe I want to see. Yes. Do we have any biosecurity agency in India? Actually, we do not have, you know, any official such organization is not there. But, you know, ICMR and Department of Biotechnology is, you know, taking care of biosafety. And biosafety may he thoda sa, you know, biosecurity is also a small part of biosafety. So you can consider it like that. But there is no so far in India. Okay. So we should empower, you know, we should first establish the biosecurity agencies and we should also empower them. Okay. We should carry out an environmental impact assessment and risk assessment as a part of evolution process, right? It is very important because after doing evaluation only, you know, evaluation only, you can find out actually there is invasion or not. Even though there is invasion, but there is no risk associated with it, then there is no problem, you know. when we call it invasive alien species, even though it's alien, but if it is not invasive, it means it is not harmful, then no problem, it can come, right? Flora and fauna keep on changing, it's a natural process, right? So that is not an issue. But if it is harmful, then that assessment has to be done, risk assessment must be done, right? The intending importers, the person who is bringing in the invasive alien species, must be given the responsibility and should provide the proof that a proposed introduction will not be harmful. Okay? Then only, you can somehow control it. Because somebody is responsible, then they will not repeat those mistakes, or they will not create a nuisance, right? So, impose containment conditions on an introduction if and where appropriate. It means we can impose containment means we can stop, we can hide it somewhere, we can close the materials somewhere, and we will not allow anybody to use it for maybe a period of time or for permanently or something like that, right? So impose containment condition on an introduction if and where appropriate. In addition, monitoring requirements are often necessary following release as a part of management. This is very important, So initially, what we thought, as in government organization, we had thought like, okay, the product which they have brought or the species they have brought is not harmful. It's not invasive. It is foreign, but it is not invasive, and we have allowed it. Fine. That does not mean that your job is over. Post release also, we must check whether this alien species is invasive or not. Because again, if it is invasive, you will have to take appropriate actions to control it. Otherwise, it could be very dangerous. Okay? Similarly, develop clinical panelist and civil liabilities for the consequent eradication or control cost of unauthorized institutional introductions. So this is also very important. Penalty ke bina to it's very difficult. If there is no law, criminal law or these things, people will not listen to you. So this is very important to have. Okay, following this, how prevention measures have got failed. Now what we have to do? It has got spread. We have to eradicate it. Right? We have to eradicate it. And for eradication of something, you need, very solid mechanisms. But until you have the solid mechanisms or proper eradication facilities, you just have to control it. Right now, we are in that stage only. We are right now not in position to eradicate coronavirus, this novel coronavirus too. We are not in position of eradicating it right now because we do not have effective antibiotic or antiviral drug to it, control it, and even we do not have effective vaccine. Now, some vaccines are coming. Hopefully, in future we might eradicate it, but currently we are not in position to eradicate it. Eradication is the best practice to control any invasive microorganisms. So right now, what we are doing with coronavirus, we are just controlling its spread. How we are controlling it? We are using a combination of methods. We are using masks, we are using hand sanitizers, we are washing our hands regularly, we are not going into crowded areas, we are maintaining distance. So these are a combination of methods we are following to control it. So eradication and control is two different things. Eradication is a complete process. When everything is end, when there is no new cases of this virus, we will call the virus has got. Now there is no new cases of poliovirus. So we can say that poliovirus has been eradicated, but only because of a solid reason, that was vaccine. We have two vaccines for polio. Okay. But right now we are controlling the virus. So controlling is an ongoing process. I hope the point is clear. So we will finish last two slides only left. So eradication. Where it is achievable, though it's a little difficult, but wherever it is achievable, promote eradication as the best management option for dealing with alien invasive species where prevention has failed. Okay, it is much more cost effective financially than ongoing control. See, if you will take vaccine once, maybe vaccine is 1,000 rupees, you will take that vaccine, no problem. That's it, you will spend 1,000 rupees, maybe two doses, 2,000 rupees. But see, we are regularly buying sanitizers, we are regularly buying masks, right? We are taking other so many precautions, right? So because of that, we are losing a lot of financial things. We are losing a lot of money. Many of the people are not able to go to jobs and so many problems. So they're losing money, right? So that's why eradication is financially more viable than ongoing control and better for the environment also. See, now you will throw the mask after use. What you will do? You're using various chemicals, sanitizer. They're spraying that, chemicals and all. So all of them are very good, bad for environment. When a potentially alien invasive species is first detected, mobilize and activate sufficient resources and expertise quickly. This is very important for early eradication. See, if we could have controlled, how many of you think that if India would have banned the flights, before few days instead of that what they did, and they would have, if they would have quarantined the people who were coming from foreign countries, would be able to effectively control it, or whether we have taken right decisions for corona? The people who were coming from foreign countries, if they would have been quarantined properly, the disease could have been handled more effectively, right? So that is the same point which has been discussed here, right? So when a potentially live alien invasive species first detected, mobilize and activate sufficient resources and expertise quickly. This is very important. Take a grip species has occurred and is not yet be well established, because in those areas it will be very easy to eradicate it completely. Somewhere where it has widely spread it, then it will take time to control it. But the areas where very few cases are there, you can easily control it, right? Eradication methods are as specific as possible. It may vary organism to organism, right? So the method should be as specific as possible, with the objective of having no long-term effect on non-target native species. For example, you want to eradicate this virus, and you think, okay, I will spray this sanitizers everywhere. So, along with this virus, other microorganisms, maybe soil beneficial microorganisms, and so many other microbes, which is part of biosphere, will also be damaged, which is not good. So for short term, if there is effect, then no problem. But there should not be any long-term toxicity to the non-target native species, which is very important while doing eradication. We should also ensure that persistence of toxin in the environment does not occur as a result of eradication. You should not be using some chemical which will stay there in the environment and causes further toxicity, secondary toxicities, and so on, right? Ensure that during eradication, biosafety guidelines are strictly being followed. Again, I will say you, those who want to learn biosafety, biosecurity, you can join our website. You can join our, training, which we will conduct in February month. Give priority to the eradication of alien invasive species on isolated area. You might have heard recently about containment zones. So that containment zones or isolation area is same thing. So a priority has to be given to for the eradication of alien species in containment zones or in isolation areas where the density of the disease is very high. And the last point in this is control, how we can control them. So for controlling, prioritize the alien invasive species problems, right? Then we should draw up a formal control strategy that includes identifying the target organisms, area for control, and the methodology and timing. Now, this is very important. See, some of you might be expecting ki, I haven't told you attention here. You know how to control. All of you are from biology background. You know how to kill a microorganism. We have various type of chlorine-based disinfectants. Okay, we have various kind of chemicals by which we can control. So, that is not my, main intention. My main intention is to tell you how you can, plan everything, right? So that is very important. So we have to draw up a formal control strategy that includes identifying the target organisms, area for control, methodology, and timing. The strategy may apply to the part of a place, part of a state, part of a country, or even to the whole country. It depends on you and how well you can, how many, people you are having to follow your strategy, how much resources you are having to follow. Okay? So according to that, you can choose the size of the area. Such strategies should be publicly available. Okay, this is very important, and it should be open for public inputs, and it should be regularly reviewed whether your strategy is effective or not. If it is not effective, it should be open for modifications. ठीक है, वी शुड एवेल्युएट वेदर लॉन्ग टर्म रिडक्शन ऑफ एलियन स्पीशीज इज मोर लाइकली टू बी अचीव्ड बाय अडॉप्टिंग वन एक्शन और ए सेट ऑफ लिंक्ड एक्शन और यू कैन से मल्टीपल एक्शन विच आई ऑलरेडी एक्सप्लेन यू. फॉर एग्जाम्पल वी आर यूजिंग वट वी आर यूजिंग वी आर यूजिंग मल्टीपल थिंग्स टू सेव आवर सेल्फ फ्रॉम कोरोना वायरस नॉट वन थिंग. सो इट डिपेंड्स इफ वन थिंग इज इफेक्टिव लाइक इफ आई वॉन्ट टू प्रोटेक्ट माई सेल्फ फ्रॉम यू नो कॉलरा वट आई विल डू आई विल इंस्टॉल ए वाटर प्यूरिफायर इन माई होम एंड आई विल ड्रिंक एंड यूज द वाटर फ्रॉम दैट ओनली. सो वन स्ट्रेटजी इट सेल्फ इज वेरी वेरी इफेक्टिव बट If I want to save myself from coronavirus, I will have to use multiple strategies, multiple things at a time, right? I told you like masks, sanitizer, hand washing, distance, and so on. So I hope.